Are you up? Are you twisted? Here, let's unhook your toe.
Sometimes it stops me in my tracks. There was a time when I didn't imagine what next week would be like for Isaac. He was so sick all of the time.
Still waking up?
Yeah, I know. This'll wake you up quick. Thank you. But you don't really think about the cost that goes into caring for your child when you're sitting there watching it happen. I'd never checked my insurance statement to see what it was costing us. Everybody was like, oh, this plan's great. You guys are covered 100%. You have nothing to worry about. And so I didn't worry about it. But, you know, that only lasts for so long, apparently. Back in 2008, 2009.
We have been debating healthcare for decades. Every single one of you, at some point, have met constituents with heartbreaking stories. And you've looked them in the eye and you've said, we're gonna do something about it. That's why I wanna go to Congress. And now, we're on the threshold of doing something about it.
Having all Americans covered with health insurance is a holy grail. It always was the goal that everybody saw it from really all ideological perspectives, although the paths they chose were different. It all got started by Theodore Roosevelt.
Germany had sort of started to give health insurance to its population, and you know, there was a thought that that might happen here, and it didn't. And then in the 1930s, Franklin Roosevelt had wanted to put health care in Social Security and was advised not to.
Through Truman, it became part of the Democratic Party platform. And then Lyndon Johnson was able to carry it off, and we got Medicare and Medicaid.
And we marvel not simply at the passage of this bill, but what we marvel at is that it took so many years to pass it.
And then after that, it really was off until 1993.
For the first time in this century, leaders of both political parties have joined together around the principle of providing universal, comprehensive health care. It is a magic moment, and we must seize it.
So I had worked in the Clinton administration and was involved in the Clinton health reform effort, which famously failed.
One of the problems with the Clinton plan was that the stakeholders, particularly the insurance companies and the drug companies, they were on the outside throwing rocks in. So there was all of this groundwork that was laid when Obama got elected. The idea was maybe we should sit down with all the stakeholders and see what they could live with, because everybody agreed the system wasn't functioning very well.
Our goal is to try to address all of these challenges, and we're doing it by working with Congress and stakeholders across the system, including you.
This part of politics is a team sport. It's not easy.
It was really sort of exciting, but it was never inevitable. It almost died so many times.
You needed a president that was willing to take it on. That's one thing about President Obama, was that he and his team decided this was going to be a priority, and that was the approach they took.
Hi, handsome. How was school?
Good.
Good.
I had actually had a miscarriage right before I had Isaac, so he was technically my rainbow baby.
Hey, hang that backpack up, please.
Went in for the 18-week ultrasound, and that's how we found out that there was potentially something big going on with him.
Why are you singing Baby Shark?
How did you know?
Because I can hear you doing it.
Esophageal atresia, it falls under an umbrella. There are actually five different diagnoses. So he was born, he had a piece of his esophagus up here, he had a little piece coming out of his stomach, but absolutely nothing in the middle. In Isaac's first 13 months, he hit $2 million. And that was in 1 year of almost nonstop ICU care and 14 major surgeries. We brought him home when he was about 13 months old. It was February of 2010. I'd placed his regular medical supply order and nothing arrived in the mail. So I called and she said, oh, he doesn't have insurance. There's nobody to pay for this. And I said, what do you mean he doesn't have insurance? That was when we were notified that Isaac had lost his health insurance. I felt like I'd let Isaac down at that point. This is my job to make sure he's healthy and safe and he's seeing the right doctors. And I can't do that without access to insurance for him. When Isaac lost his health care, it was February of 2010, and the ACA was signed into law about a month later.
I've been on Capitol Hill since the early 1980s. That was the craziest day I ever experienced on Capitol Hill, was the day that it finally passed.
Let's get this done.
That whole day was surreal.
There were an enormous amount of protesters that were all over the Capitol grounds.
There was a lot of heat about it.
And there was a feeling of sort of sitting there witnessing history.
It was a little bit scary.
On this vote, the yeas are 219, the nays are 212. The motion to concur in the Senate amendment is adopted. Without objection, the motion to reconsider is laid on the table.
It was surreal. You no longer have to worry if you have a pre-existing condition that your lifetime and annual limits will no longer be a factor. It just makes a huge difference in people's peace of mind.
Today, after almost a century of trouble, today, after all the votes have been tallied, health insurance reform becomes law in the United States of America. Today.
Isaac today is amazing. He is the most typical 11-year-old you'll probably ever find. And when I look outside and see him with his friends and riding his bike and playing, he is living the life he was intended to live. And it's a life that we weren't sure he was going to live at one point in time. We used to say, you know, gosh, look at Isaac. He could be the guy who cures cancer. He could be the next president. But I don't think it should have to come to that to justify why Isaac deserves health care more than any other person. You know, if he's just being the best Isaac that he can be someday, I'm happy. If he's happy, everything else falls into place.